Hello, and welcome to Oakland Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are here with us today. It is, I'm telling you, as a congregation, as a church, it is amazing and it is humbling that you trust us with your precious ones, with your kids, and we take that so seriously. We hope that they have a positive experience, and it's just a particular joy when our children's choir is singing and when our preschool is here to be able to get to know you and let you know you're a part of our church family too. So welcome to all of you. And hey, let's get started with a little bit of housekeeping. If you have a smartphone with you, point it at the QR code, which should be in front of you, either in your bulletin or on the rail in front of you. And that'll take you to a place where you can let us know that you are here. We would love to get to know you a little bit better. Share with us an email address if you'd like to know what's going on in the life of this church. We'll keep you informed. Then also, it's a way for you to give an offering if you would like to give to the work of Jesus Christ in the world through this church. We would be proud to have you as our partner, and you can give electronically there through that app as well. If you brought an offering in hand or you want to fill out one of the paper connection cards, that's fine too. Just drop that off in a drop box that's in the back. And then right over here as you leave. We also want to say a special thank you to all of our friends joining us on Facebook Live. Hello, friends. We're glad that you are with us and worshiping with us. Another thing we'd like you to do, if you have a prayer request today, we sure would like to pray for that today, right here in the service. And it doesn't matter if you're just visiting with us today, you're here because of the preschool kids. Doesn't matter to us. If there's something that's weighing on your heart today, all you have to do is use that prayer text line to let us know what that is, and I'm going to lift those up a little bit later on in the service. Just a few other things real quick. We're taking directory pictures today, so if you're a part of this church family, if you are new to this church family, we'd love to just basically immortalize how amazingly good-looking you are. We just want to celebrate how God has made you incredibly good-looking by taking your picture. And that's going to go into a directory so we can get to know each other a little bit better and put faces with names. So all you have to do is line up after the service, and our good friend Cecil is here to take some professional photographs for us. You know about Fall Festival? Yeah. Do I even need to say anything? No. I will say two things. Cakewalk and dunk tank. And guess who got roped into doing the dunk tank? Oh, applause. Thank you. You are so dumb. On a more serious note, we also want to note the passing of a great friend of this church after his fight with cancer. Pastor Anthony Hodge has gone to be with his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We rejoice about that, but we're sad for ourselves. He was an incredible mission partner. He was the director of Finding the Lost Sheep Ministries in East Winter Haven, an incredible impact on all the children that live there, and he was a community leader. If you ever went to the Martin Luther King Day celebration in Winter Garden, you would see Anthony, who was able to recite the I Have a Dream speech from memory. It was so powerful. He will be missed. His service is going to be this Saturday, at 11 o'clock. At Mosaic Church, and many of us from this church will be joining with them that day, his family that day, to celebrate his life. So let's call ourselves to worship. I just realized that I completely forgot something. The kids are supposed to have sung already. I'm so sorry. Bonnie, I'm so sorry.
Okay, we're going to sing right now.
Do you mind singing right now? Okay, I'm gonna sit down.
Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God for all goodness. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God.
let's call ourselves to worship. The words are in your bulletin. They'll also be up on the screen. We'll do this responsively. Praise is due to you, O God, O you who answers prayer. You are the hope of all things, Holy One, from the ends of the earth to the farthest seas. Rejoice in God, O people, and be glad. Remain standing and join me in a prayer where we are able to unburden ourselves before God. We're able to just release ourselves from all of the things which have caused us shame, guilt, or regret, knowing that God meets us with forgiveness, compassion, grace, and newness of life. So let's do a prayer together. I think it applies to all of us. But then also, I'm going to give you a few moments for your own personal prayer, and then I'll come back with some good news. Let's pray together. Holy God, your truth is oftentimes hard to hear. We confess our avoidance, our purposeful distractions, our prideful arrogance that keeps us from hearing and responding to your word. Although you send us messages and messengers, we dismiss and disregard those who tell us we are wrong. Have mercy upon us, Holy God. Open us to hearing the truth, no matter how it is conveyed. Amen. This time is yours. I have some good news. Because who's in a position to condemn us? Only Christ. But Christ died for us, he rose for us, he reigns in power for us, and he prays for us all the time. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, the new life has come. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. And if you wouldn't mind passing the peace to one another, just kind of twirl around in a circle, extend your hand, and say, "The peace of Christ be with you."
Right, good morning. So on Wednesday mornings, my preschool friends join me here in the sanctuary for chapel time. The children have come to know the sanctuary as a special place where we can come and worship God. We hear stories of God, we pray to God, and we sing songs to God. They are excited, they are ready. This morning they would like to share with you a couple of our special songs from chapel time. And so, all right, my friends, are you ready to sing?
Yeah.
And now at this time, I invite any children who are here with us today to come with us for Children's Church.
Corinthians chapter 12, verses 21 to 26. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you, and the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and the parts that we think are less honorable we treat with special honor, and the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, and so there should be no division in the body, so that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Samantha, that was awesome. Thank you. This is the part where you realize we just played a very dirty trick on you, preschool parents. Because now we take your kids away and you have to listen to some guy talk for 20 minutes. But I rise to the challenge. I am so excited that you're here, and I pray this is a blessing to you. Because what we've been talking about here for the last several weeks is the fact that you have something about you which is really and truly great. It is awesome, as a matter of fact. And it's an important part of this world. You have your best stuff. And I don't know what it is. Some of you are in the process of still kind of learning what your best stuff is. Maybe you're starting to get an idea about it. Some of you have been using it for years to do what you do. But what we believe here is that stuff about you makes you truly special and important for the world. And we also believe that this was built into you by your creator. So there was like an eternal thoughtfulness that went into your design with the purpose that you would make an impact, that your best stuff would make a difference in people's lives. And one of the names that's given for this is spiritual gifts. So that's what we've been talking about. And one of the spiritual gifts is leadership. Now, I would like to know, do you have this? Are you somebody who just gravitates towards being a leader? Raise your hand right now. If you are somebody, usually people who are leaders, they don't mind raising their hand. They're like, yes, I will take the lead and I will raise my hand. Unless you're really torqued right now that you're not the one asking the questions, and so you're going to rebel and kind of sit it out. No. I'm with you. This has always been something that I've gravitated towards. From as far back as I can remember, two things that I always kind of wanted to do. One was be a leader. The other one was be a public speaker. Where some people are going, you have to kill me before I'll speak in front of people. I'm like, yeah, bring it on. I've always wanted to do it. And whenever I've taken a test or assessment about, you know, your personality and your traits, leadership always comes out the highest for me. So no wonder I'm doing what I'm doing. I'm speaking every single Sunday as many times as I can, and I'm trying to be used by God to lead this church. So I was thinking about my very, very first time that I was an official leader. And it took me all the way back to elementary school when I was selected to be the captain of the safety patrol. Yeah, man. Any safety patrol? Do you guys have safety patrol at your school? Yeah, anybody in it? Nice. Anybody the captain of the safety patrol? No. You are, really? Dude. Yeah. Okay, yeah. But they give you a badge, right? And it says captain on it. So I was made, this was my very first time I was an official leader, captain of the safety patrol, and I was horrible. I was terrible. I didn't last very long. The reason was is because it totally went to my head. But the power. I wore my belt all day long. All day long. Not just in the morning and in the afternoon when you're supposed to be kind of on duty. No. I wore my belt, captain badge, all day long because I felt like now this was a part of me, and I could now. So I would write up people on the smallest infractions. I just loved that power of putting people in their place, and I made a ton of enemies. and I guess the powers that be thought, okay, he's not working out. So after a week or two, I was gone. I was done. I was put back to private, or whatever it is in safety patrol. It was a terrible experience, and I wish I could tell you that that was the last time that I was a horrible leader, but I could not stand in front of you and honestly say that. I have struggled to understand what leadership is really all about, to understand that leadership is not about titles. It's not about rank. It's not about roles. It's not about the ability to boss people around and sort of be over them. And it's certainly not about coercing people to follow you because out of fear or division. I've learned that that's not what real leadership looks like, but it raises the question, what is leadership? What is it actually? And maybe you're curious, as I tend to be, what does God say about leadership? What does the Bible say about leadership? So that's what we're going to talk about. And if you have a Bible, it would be great if you opened it up, not so we can make a big show of reading our Bibles, but so that we can kind of be looking at this and interpreting this together. That's what we believe we're doing here. This is a group effort. So 1 Corinthians 12, starting with verse 21, is the verse that I want you to kind of come back and take a look. Samantha read it. Awesome. You did a great job, Samantha. But let's kind of just revisit it again. Now, leadership does not show up. The word leadership does not show up in these verses. It does in a little bit. In two verses on, in verse 28, it's listed among some of the other spiritual gifts, special abilities that God gives people. But in this verse, the Apostle Paul wants to talk about how the church is like a body. It's very, very important Think about that right now, how the church, or frankly, in a Christian perspective, any group is like a body in which all of the various parts, even if they're hidden, even if they seem small and inconsequential, it is so important that the whole church, that all of the gifts are moving together in the same direction. It's critically important that this is a group effort, and it's something that we're kind of pulling for all together. Now, this kind of set everything on its head back in the day when this was first read out loud in a church, because people would have known this was a very different way to talk about the body, not the human body, the physical body, but as a group. Because in that day, the prevailing sort of power was the Roman Empire. And they specifically used the metaphor body to describe the citizenry, to describe the people. However, they took a different approach. And they said there are weaker parts of the body, and their role is to serve the greater parts of the body. So it was all meant to kind of prop up this aristocracy, this hierarchy, right? And it said, yeah, there's weaker parts, and their job is to make sure the greater parts are healthy and whole and doing their thing. And so it really kind of divided. And so these people, this is what they knew. This is the culture that they were a part of. They just understood it as a given. And here comes this Apostle Paul writing them a letter and saying, no, that's not God's plan. What you know about the body isn't right. The body is a whole. Everybody's important. So let me take a look at this this verse again. And if you could do the next slide, Travis. Thank you. So what I'd like you to notice are two sets of adjectives that kind of weave their way through this verse. This is very interesting, and they really kind of jump out at you. So the first set I've underlined for you, where it says you are we don't need you, you are unneeded, you are weaker, you are less honorable, and you are unpresentable. So you see all those in there? Okay, that's set one. But notice there's another set of adjectives. Let's show that. So in this set of adjectives, we have indispensable, greater honor, greater modesty. So here's the deal. What this is teaching is that everyone, all of you, are in set number two. That one applies to you. You are indispensable. You are worthy of greater honor. You are worthy of joy. You are worthy of equal concern. This is everyone, not just some of you, everyone. And no one is in set number one. No one is considered unneeded or as less worthy of honor or as less worthy of this sense of modesty, this respect that we have for each other. Everyone's in set two. No one is in set one. And leadership rarely finds itself in set number one. We rarely say leaders aren't needed, right? We rarely say that leaders are weaker. In fact, we will say leaders are indispensable. They are out front, they're dynamic, they're often powerful and authoritative, they're charismatic, and we are in a culture where leaders are considered indispensable, right? Do you agree with me on that? We need leaders. We want to be inspired by leaders. They are so very important to us. And so it's easy to be in a situation where it's kind of thought that the apex of your existence is that you are totally in control. You are the leader. No one answers to you. No one answers. You don't answer to anybody. Everybody answers to you. And that's kind of seen as the goal. That's what we want to be. We want to be on top. When you think about the movies, right? Think about movie villains. What do they always say? I am going to rule the world. I'm going to rule the world. You do not ever see somebody in a movie saying, I am going to be the third regional vice president of the world. No, they want to be at the top, right? They want to be the leader. But what Jesus does is he comes along and he says this. He says, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be the same among you. That's not my plan, is that kind of leadership. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Now keep in mind who he's talking to in this verse. He's talking to 12 people that he is called to follow him, and he is training to be the first leaders in the fledgling infancy Christian movement, the very first leaders. And this is what he's saying to them. He's basically saying that it's not about title, not about authority, not about power, not about fear. It's about something that would be better described as influential servanthood. Influentially serving. That's something that I've been taught and have to come back to all the time. Notice the main verb, serving. The modifier, influentially. Leaders are just one of the ways that people can be helpful. It's just one of the ways that people can be helpful. It's not the only way. Even though it's lifted so high and put on a pedestal, it's just one of the ways. But influence matters. And that's what leaders get to do. So here's another verse I want to share with you real quick. 1 Peter 5, 1 through 2. What this verse does, yep, there it is. What this verse does is it actually calls out and names some of the first leadership roles in the early church. I'll sort of give you the background here. If you see the word shepherd there in the middle, do you see that? Shepherd was a title that was given to a certain group of people, a certain type of leader in the church. In the Latin, it was translated into the word pastor. Ever heard of them? Okay. Somebody who was seen as a spiritual leader in the church. Now, if you go down to the third one, exercising oversight, in the Greek, that's the word episkopos. Does that ring a bell? Has anybody ever heard of Episcopal church? Well, that describes a structure in which individual churches have their leadership, but then there's leadership over kind of a group of churches, maybe in a town or in a city or in a region, and so that became known as bishops. But the one that kind of stands out and gets the most comment is the first one, elder. And this gets repeated all throughout the New Testament. An elder, what they were in the church is they ran the church. They were the leadership of the church, but they always did it as a group, as a council. That's how the New Testament describes it, that the church was led by a group of people. Literally, the word means old man. Literally, the word elder, translated here, means old man. But what that came to mean is those that had wisdom and respect in a town, and everybody would come to them with their problems because they were so wise and they were so trusted to come up with a just conclusion. Well, this was co-opted by the church. And so the group of elders became the council that ran the church. Do you know the Greek word for elder? Presbyteros. Presbyteros, from which we get the word Presbyterian. A little plug. Because we're run by a council of elders. Some of you are here. Raise your hand if you're on the session. You're an elder. Yep, we have a bunch of you here. What also this verse says is that, look at that word, not under compulsion. So this is not meant to be domineering style of leadership. Real quick, let's look at what domineering leadership is. I went to a website, leadershipreview.net, and it said that domineering leadership is characterized by these qualities. Somebody enjoys making decisions and giving orders. Someone who talks more than others, sometimes verbally sort of almost intimidating and commanding. Uses their permission to make others do their will rather than coming up with a plan together. And prioritizes getting things done over relationships and getting things done together. It's all about doing it their way. Anybody ever had a boss or a coach or a teacher, parent, who was kind of a domineering leader? Yeah, so you know what the effect that is. It doesn't lift you up. It keeps you down. And so this is not biblical leadership. I'm just going to tell you right now, this is not what biblical leadership looks like at all. What does leadership look like? From a biblical perspective, I'm going to do that now, and then I'll be done. I promise I'll be done. Biblical leadership, first, is based on humility, respect, and maturity. Biblical leadership is based on humility, respect, and maturity over things like authority and charisma. Secondly, biblical leadership is about leading by example, kind of like as a shepherd does. It's about inviting people to be a part of kind of a mission together where the whole group is going together. It's not just because of title, position, and personality. It's about being trustworthy. When you lead people someplace, you may not know where you're going, but when you get there, it's a good place. It's a place of learning, it's a place of experience, a place of challenge, and it brings us closer to God and to each other. Leaders are basically people who are gifted with a wider point of view. They are big picture people who are able to make complex problems simple and say, let's just do this. They're able to inspire a vision for what the group could achieve together. They paint that picture. They say, I'm excited. Let's go together. Let's figure this out together. And then finally, you're probably seeing that I'm leading to this. Biblical leadership shares leadership. It doesn't hoard it. It shares it with others. And it always wants to work as a team as opposed to just being the one that always calls the shots. I'm just going to say in closing that I see the church today, and it is in dire need of this biblical leadership, because we've, over the last few decades, we kind of, I would say, have gotten into a pattern where pastors being more trendy or charismatic or awesome speakers or having star power, that has become more important than maturity and respect and humility. And so as a result, these churches have not been sustainable that have had this kind of leadership. It usually ends whenever that leader steps away. That's not a good vision for the church. Also, I would say in our culture, we have gotten into sort of a bad habit, I would say, of gravitating towards leaders who exercise their leadership through intimidation and division. And that's not biblical either. As we need Christian leaders to actually any leaders that actually do what the Bible is saying in terms of humble leadership. That's what we need way more of than I would say the kind of leadership that we have. That's my opinion. But it seems like the evidence backs it up. So, do you know someone who has been an awesome leader in your life? Do you know someone? I want you to lock that person into your brain right now, and I want you to make a promise to yourself right now that this week you're going to get in touch with that person, and you're going to say thank you. Thank you for being a person who has influentially served in my life. Coach, teacher, parent, mentor, boss, whatever it is, somebody who has been just an awesome example of leadership in your life, they need to know that they're appreciated. Just send them a note. Give them a call. Stop by their office. Whatever it takes this week. Do it this week. Can you do that? I'm bossing you around, aren't I? No, but I think this. And then also, pray for leaders in all churches. Pray for leaders to be raised up in our society who are humble, who are respectful, and who are mature. They're comfortable with themselves, they're comfortable with their strengths and weaknesses, and they're comfortable sharing leadership with others. We need to pray for our all of our churches and pray for our society that these are the kind of leaders that get a chance to lead and not others. Can you do that too? Pray, say thank you. That's all I'm asking. All right, let's pray right now. Gracious God, thank you so much for leaders. We're thinking of the one who's been a leader in our life, or maybe several. They have been so important to us. And so we ask and we pray right now that you would bless them, that you would strengthen their gift, that you would help them to submit themselves to you, that you would help them to see the strength of being accountable and being humble when they mess up. Help us to be a culture that honors biblical leadership. And now, Lord, as we transition into prayers of all of us, we bring to mind those who have been damaged or have been terrorized or threatened by horrible leaders in their life. Those who have had their sense of worth taken away from them, their sense of value taken away from them. And Lord, we ask that you would bring healing. We're all lifting up people that we know well who need prayer today. We're thinking about those who are sick or hospitalized, those who are recovering from treatments or surgeries. We're thinking about those who really are struggling right now emotionally. We are thinking about those who are mourning or grieving a loss that is really keenly felt. Someone has texted a prayer request for a young woman with cancer. Lord, we just pray that you would bring healing. Someone texted that we would pray for Doug and Dennis and John, three men who all recently passed on. We pray for their families, Lord. We ask that you would provide comfort and healing. Someone's asking prayer for Nelson Santiago as he is recovering from major surgery. Yes, Lord, bring healing. We're praying for Zoe, who displaced her kneecap this past week and had to go to the hospital. Actually, I met somebody else who had that happen not too long ago. And we give thanks that through the skill of the doctors and wearing a brace, that they are doing better. And praying that there would be no long-term damage. Lord, I just want to lift up these families right now. Being a parent these days is hard. There's so many people telling us what to do, but so few that give us guidance and mentorship. And so, Lord, I pray that you would provide for these families, that you would give them spiritual friends who are wise and helpful and respectful and are willing to walk with them through the challenges of parenting. Lord, I pray that if they feel lost, if they struggle, Lord, that you would come to them with comfort and assurance and confidence. I pray all these things in the name of Jesus. And together we pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So now, God, as we get ready to go out into the world, we come and we stand before you, maybe for the very first time, to say thank you. Thank you for all the good gifts that you have given us, especially the gift of your Son, Jesus, how he died on the cross to set us free so that we could live the life that we were created to live. And now, God, take us and use us to accomplish your glorious purposes. Share your unconditional love in the world, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You want to do it? Okay, no, we'll just go. All right. We're good. We're good. I pray that you go with God's grace to enfold you, the love of Jesus to uphold you, the power of the Spirit to mold you and keep you in great joy. Go in peace. Have a great week. Thank you for your precious children. I'll see you at the dunk tank.